Hi everyone, good to see you. So before we start, do you have any question?
Yes, can you repeat briefly what you are trying to do after the fixation thing? Can we try to manipulate things to the end?
Which part?
And long you said the limit and going to infinite and we try
the whole calculation?
Yeah, what are you trying to do?
Ah, what I'm trying, okay, but you want to repeat the calculation or you want to repeat the
what
one?
Is it?
Okay. So what we did is that we assume that we have a master equation in some space, and basically when we have a master equation, we wrote the master equation in terms of you can look at it as like sums over some states, or if you are at continuous states, you can continuous configuration as an integral over this configuration. Okay, and so you have the sum or the integral over the configurations where you're not, and you have the rate at which you go from x prime to x. If you want p, the probability of being in x prime, minus the rate at which you go from x to x prime, the probability of being in x. Of course, I use now a different notation than what I used last time, and I was using for the rate from to go from x prime to x, I was using x prime and this x prime. Okay. And then basically what we did is that we rewrote this this integral as a series of we basically Taylor expand these terms. And the idea of the Taylor expansion is that when you look at these rates Vx prime of x, you can look at the difference x prime minus x, let's call it y. So this difference here is how much you move in one, what is the rate of moving by a quantity y. Okay. And basically we Taylor expand this y. Okay. This is what we did. And by doing that, what we found is another expression which looks like the sum from n to 1 to infinity minus 1 n, n factorial, the derivative, n derivative of x of some alpha n of x, n of x, where this alpha n of x is equal to the integral in dx prime of x prime minus x w x prime given x. Okay, go to the end. So if you look at this term, this is something, I mean, this is not a probability, it's a rate, but this is something like a moment of this rate. If you divide by the total rate, if you make this a probability, you normalize it, this is the moment. Up to normalization factor, this is the moment. And this is the end moment of the jumps. Okay. And so the idea, I mean, and this is exactly what we're going to do now, is that you're going to look at specific cases, and we're going to look at this expansion. We're going to calculate all the terms, and then we're going to see that in some interesting regimes, you can basically remove all the terms from 3 to infinity. Okay. This expansion is correct. There is no, there isn't any approximation in writing this equation. Okay, we didn't approximate anything. We have all the terms. Any question? I mean, you can think of these as just. I mean, here you have something on the left, which is a function. Okay, and this is a function of the x, and we basically wrote some sort of the we brought the Taylor expansion of this function on the right. So. Okay. Any question, comments? Does this answer your question?
Yes.
Okay, let's keep it here then. Okay, so I want to start by looking at some specific cases. Okay, and the first example I want to make, then we're gonna make example with the models we've considered, like the Varette-Fischer model and the Morin model. But I want to start with a simple random walk. So you have a random walk in one dimension. You are in a given site, let's say X. And what you do is that you move with some rate d over 2, you move to the right, and with some rate d over 2, you move to the left. Oh, no, actually, you want the question. No. So you have a rate at which you move to the right and a rate at which you move to the left. Okay. And I could say that this is position x plus 1, x plus 2. But I want to say that this is position x plus delta x. And this is x plus 2 delta x, etc. Okay. So what are the rates here? What is w x prime given x? Well, this is d, but I mean you can move to, if you start from x, you can move only to some x prime
delta.
Exactly. So this is d, the delta x prime x plus delta x plus d delta x prime x minus delta x. Okay. This is the process, right? These are the rates, and this defines the process. Of course, here I erase the only thing I didn't have to erase. So this is alpha n of x is equal to the integral x minus x prime minus x n w. So I write this, so you could write the Fokker Planck, the master equation. Okay. And of course, equivalently, you can write this expansion. Right? So this expansion, I have to determine what are these moments here. So what are those moments? Well, these moments are the integral of this times this. Okay. Now, just to clarify the notation, I'm sort of jumping very freely and happily between discrete states, continuous states with integrals, and then going back and forth without being specific at every time. But I hope this doesn't make you uncomfortable. If it does, I'm really sorry. But, okay, but everything should be clear, right? So if you want, you could say, oh, if these are, if I interpret this as continuous states, these are Dirac delta functions, otherwise they are Kronecker delta. This is a sum or an integral, but we understand each other. Okay. So I want to write this. And this, of course, the dx prime, well, it is alpha f of x. Is equal to d, okay, times this delta function. And when I integrate with this delta function, I get delta x n plus d. Then I have the other delta function here, and I have minus delta x n. So this term here is equal to what? Is equal to 2 b delta x to the n, n is even, and 0 if n is odd. Okay? So it means that in this series I have only the even terms and I don't have the odd terms. Okay? And if I look at the first odd term that I the first even term that I have is the one with n equal to 2. Okay. Then I have n equal to 4, etc. Now, as you imagine, well, let's write the first two terms, right? So the first term is this is 1, this is 2, cancel the 2, so you have d, the second derivative over x of, well, this doesn't depend on x, so you have d delta x squared of x plus, now I write the fourth term, which is the next term that matters, which is 2 over 4 factorial d delta x to the 4 dx to dx, okay, etc. Okay. Now, what I can do is that I can if I'm interested in taking some sort of continuous limit where I send this delta x to 0, okay, I immediately see two things. Okay. So the first thing I see is that all the terms, I mean, as I increase the power of these terms, the terms become subleading, right? So this term is subleading compared to this term, the sixth power is subleading to the previous term, etc. I have increasing power of delta x, which is the quantity I want to send to zero. So if I send delta x to zero, this tends to zero compared to this. Okay. Is this clear? Okay. So this is the first thing I observe. The second thing I observe is that if I keep this term here, I have something dp. T equal to t delta x squared, t squared, t squared, over x. And what I see is that, I mean, also this term goes to zero, right? I mean, this is small. Looks like it's small. Unless this parameter here is of the order of 1 over x squared. Okay? Or unless I look at times which are order 1 over this term, okay? But the point is that I want to define a parameter which is called d, which is actually the diffusion constant, which is finite, and this becomes the usual diffusion equation, okay? So there are two messages, which are two distinct messages and are both very important. So the first message is that in this calculation, then I say, oh, I have this parameter, which determines how far I go somehow, and I want to send this parameter to zero. The first thing I learn is that this series actually becomes a series, becomes an expansion in this term here that I want to send to zero. This is the first message. The second message is that if I want to have an equation which is not dp dt equal to zero, okay, so if I want to observe interesting phenomena, I need that this parameter here is finite in the limit of delta x going to zero. Okay. What does it mean that this parameter is finite? It means that this parameter here, d, okay, is something that has both the dimension inside has both the dimension of space, and is also a rake that has dimension of time. So this describes the time scale and the spatial scale at which I see something that is interesting. I don't see an equation which is dp dt equal to zero. The second message might be a little bit more confusing. With the next example, is going to be I think, clearer, because it relates to something that you have already seen. Okay. Any question about this? So you see that this is a very natural way to get the continuous limit. Okay, basically. So we have this discrete space, and we say somehow, well, this difference is small. Okay, we want to send this parameter to zero. We plug it in. We found the leading terms. The leading term is the second term. We can neglect all the others, and we get. Okay. If you want, as an exercise. Or as I mean, exercise as you don't have anything else to do, you could look at these days. But this is minus p over 2, and this is the 1 plus p over 2. Okay. So if the two rates are different going from the left or going from the right, okay, so you can repeat the calculation. The difference is that you, this is not going to be equal to zero, of course. And this is going to be perhaps different or perhaps not, and play with this. Okay. You have a question? No. Can we move on? You want to see this explicitly? Try it, and if you have doubt, ask. Let's now start with something you are either less or more familiar with, which is the Moran model. Okay. So the way we define the Moran model is that we say we have a rate, we go from n to n plus 1, and this rate is n over n. Minus one over. And then you have a rate to go from n minus one, n, which is exactly the same. What I want to do now, what I want to do at the end, the point where I want to go, is to take the limit of large capital N. Okay. So if I want to take the limit of large capital N, somehow the natural variable to introduce is the fraction of individuals X. Okay. So if I write the, so what I'm going to do now is to write the rates in terms of these fraction of individuals X instead of the rates written in terms of discrete number of individuals. Okay. So I want to write this thing here. Okay. So of course, this is just tautology, nothing. So what are these rates here? So, well, here you have two rates, right? So if you go, if you start from X, well, you can go, look at this term. If you start from N, you go to N plus one. So in this case, you go from X to X plus one over N. And here you go from X to X minus one over N. But these rates here look What? Oh, sorry. Let's put the B in front, which gives the. So what is the this expression here? Well, there are two possibilities. I like to go to x plus one or two. This is equal to, if you go in the first case, you have b x 1 minus x, the rate, delta x prime x plus 1 over n. Okay. And then you have b x 1 minus x, delta x prime x 1 minus x. Yes,
don't we have also the case m remains equal?
Yes, if you want, we can write. Okay, let's say that you. Okay, I'm going to show you that this doesn't matter.
Okay,
so you have this term here. Okay. Times here you can write whatever qx, okay, whatever. Write whatever function you want. Now the terms we want to write is this, okay? So this is the alpha n of x is equal to what? You can already see that that term doesn't matter, right?
Oh, yeah.
Because this depends on the difference x prime minus x. So if x prime and x are the same, these terms are all zero. Which makes sense, right? You don't care what is the rate at which you stay where you are. If that rate is infinite or is zero, nothing changes. But you can see explicitly when you write this term here, right? You have delta x prime x, when you substitute it here, that's zero. So you have these two terms, right? And these two terms are, well, you have b, x1 minus x, and then you have one, over n the n power, and then here you have a plus, and the other case you have a minus. So this is actually, oh, let's write it as before. So this is actually b x 1 minus x 1 over n to the n power. Oh shit, this is not the same n as the let's call this is the k power. Here you have the k power. So you have this expression if k is even and zero if k is odd. Okay. Is this clear? There is a two. And we are in a situation that is similar to before, right? So you see that in some sense, the point where I want to go is to look at the case where n is very, very large, okay? Where n is a very large number. And when n is a very large number, this term here, I mean, all the terms becomes increasing powers of 1 over n. So the leading term is the one with the lowest n, which is 2. Okay. So if you write that expansion at the leading term, what we get is t equal to the two cancels with the twist expansion. So we have b. Now the fundamental difference from before is that this term here depends on x. While before, this term in the diffusion, in the random mode, didn't depend on it. So in this case, we have b over n squared, the second derivative, x1 minus x, dx. Okay. Okay. I'll keep it as written like this, so this is more unknown. Now, if you write it like this, of course, this term is a small number, okay, which means that this is a small term. So it means that you see a difference, you have to go to very large terms. Let's repeat the calculation for the Wright-Fisher model. Okay. So for the Wright-Fisher model, I wrote the Wright-Fisher model as a discrete time model, but you could easily make it continuous by just adding a rate at which is a rate set. So in that case, you have the rate at which you go from n to n plus one, to n prime n is equal to what? Is equal to n this right. The Wright-Fisher model is just binomial set. So if I want to write this expression here, this expression will look like what? Well, I can just substitute x that expression, okay? And what I get is that this is x prime n. X. So this x prime n 1 minus x. Yes.
Then we need a capital N.
This is capital N.
It's not supposed to be out.
Usually you write it like this, right? The biggest number is down, right? No, so I'm wrong.
I think we should have the biggest is
up. Usually is up?
Yeah, if it's usually is up, fantastic.
I wrote the other way around. Okay, but you think it's usually up?
Yeah.
Is this something?
Because it's a factorial value, but.
I trust you, but I don't trust you. All right. Yes. I think I spent all my life writing the other way around. Okay. Good. So, what are these differences here? Oh no, I didn't have to. I'm looking at the differences between x prime and x. Okay. So looking at the difference between x prime and x is basically looking at the moments. I have to look at n prime minus n divided by n. Okay. The kth power. And this is sum over the n prime from 0 to n times the rate of the jump, which is this one times, let's say, factor to the front. This one, and the probability is n prime. And here I have n over n prime, 1 minus n over n minus n prime. Right? Do you agree that this is the thing we have to calculate?
And I think that progression is the power of the 1 minus x. X prime.
Oh no, yes, it's 1 minus. But this is the expression, right, that we want to. So since I want to write this as a function of x, now I can substitute. I'm going to keep it here. N, here I'm going to write minus x, and here I'm going to write x, and here I'm going to write x. Okay, this is exactly alpha k of x. Okay, so if you look at the dependency, okay, so this term, and this is basically moments of the binomial distribution. Okay. If you look at the terms here, well, the first term is clearly equal to zero, right? Because if you have these equal to one, okay, you have that this is the n prime over n, the expectation of n prime is exactly x times n. Or let's go slow. Let's look at alpha one x. Okay, alpha one x is b, and then I have two terms, right? So this is equal to one k. So you have the sum over n of this number here minus x times this. So what is the first thing is the sum is 1 over n, the sum n prime, and here I have the distribution, right? n prime, x n prime, 1 minus x, n minus n prime. And then I have minus x times n prime, the distribution. Okay. This, okay, so this is just the sum over n of the distribution. So by normalization of the binomial, this is equal to 1. Okay. And this is the average, the expectation of m prime. So this expectation of m prime is equal to x times n. So this is equal to 0. Agreed? Now, what is alpha 2 x? Alpha 2 x, I can divide by n squared. Okay, so I can write it as p n squared. Well, actually, all the alpha k, I can write them as p over n to the power k. Times what? Times the sum over n prime from 0 to n, n prime minus nx to the k, n n prime, x n prime, 1 minus x, n minus n prime. So what is this? Nx is exactly the average of n prime according to the distribution. Okay. So these are all the central moments of the binomial distribution. So for instance, if you have here equal to 2, this sum here gives the variance of a binomial distribution. Do you agree? You can say yes, you can say no, you can say maybe. Do you agree? Maybe. So this is the average, right? Nx is the average of the binomial. So n prime minus the average, okay, to some power is the central moment. K is equal to 2. This is the average. Okay, I'm calculating an average of n prime minus the average squared. So that's the balance.
It's like the cumulant.
Huh?
It's like the cumulant.
It's not the cumulant. It's the cumulant up to, I thought for a long time that they were, yes, the cumulant, because up to the second moments are the same, but they are,
okay,
are the central moments. The cumulants, yeah, so there is a slight difference.
So it's like V divided n capital to the k, where the expected value of n prime minus the mean,
exactly, the k. Exactly. So I mean, from the fourth moment, the third moment only, you don't care, but the second moment is the variance. Anyway, this is something that for the binomial, if you open the Wikipedia page of the binomial, you find it. Okay, what is this this expectation here, right? And you can calculate. How do you calculate if you want? Well, you can expand these for all the k, use all the moments. Okay, it's just playing with moments. Or you use the there is another way. You calculate the moment generating function, and then you can take the log, and the log of the moment generating function is generates the central moment. Oh, actually generates the cumulant.
Yeah,
yes. Right. Yes. Well, you can calculate this. Okay, so it's not the okay. So these terms here, okay, so this is equal to p over n squared. These terms here depends on n as the power of k over 2. Well, let's do this because it's easy. Let's do this for k equal to 2, alpha 2 of x. So in that case, we have p over n squared. Okay, and then this is the variance of the binomial distribution, which you all know is equal to
p one minus
n, yes, x one minus x. Okay, So the second moment, the alpha 2 is b over n x 1 minus x. Yes.
X capital and x, you said, is the average of n prime.
Yes, nx is the average of n prime. We did it here. The average of n prime is exactly this, by definition. And the average of the binomial with weight x is x times n. So this is equal to n prime in this notation. So you can repeat this calculation for all the k's. And what you get is b over n to the k. Well, you get two cases. K is even, and if k is odd. If k is even, you get b n to the k. And the moment, the central moment to the k power is k says n to the k over 2 times some function of x. And if k is odd, it is b n over k, n to the k over 2 minus 1, of k. Okay. If you repeat the calculation, you have that this term here, so leaving this outside, is n to the k over 2 g of k x, if k is even. And you have k over 2 minus 1 if k is odd. And so g of 1x is equal to 0. G of 2x is equal to x 1 minus 1, 1 minus x. G of 3x is equal to something else. Like 3x squared 1 minus x squared. You go on the Wikipedia page, you find it. Okay. What we care now is that this term here, if k is even, is b n to the k over 2 minus k. So it's minus k over 2. Right. And b n in this case is n minus k over 2 minus 1. Okay. So again, we see what? We see that as you increase k, the power decreases. Okay. Well, the power, I mean, as you increase k, the contribution of this term decreases in the limit of n going to infinity. So again, we see that the leading term is the second moment, the one we got here. And so if we write the equation for the Moran model, the leading term for the Bragg-Fisher model over this, the leading term, what we get is P over N over 2, there is this 2 here, b squared, and okay, so any question? There is one important lesson in what we found, which is there are two important lessons. One is that except this term here, they are the same. The other important lesson is that this term here is different. But
they have a different rate.
Yes, and this is very similar to
we have already kind of seen this thing before in the exponential behavior of
exactly. So in the calculation of the heterozygosity, what we found is that the heterozygosity in the Wright-Fisher model decayed at e to the minus, well, we wrote this, and in this case, heterozygosity decreased as okay, assuming v equal to 1. Right. So the important message here is that these results that we found for the heterozygosity, the fact that the heterozygosity had the same decay up to a rescaling of time, right? So that they were very similar, they were both exponential, but the time scale was different, is not something that we found by chance, and is not something that applies only to heterozygosity. It applies to every possible moment, so the full probability. The evolution in time of the probability is exactly the same for the two models, up to this term here, which is a time scale, is an inverse of a time scale. Okay. If you change the time scale here, you get exactly the same model. Right? Up to, I mean, you have the same model up to this time scale. You see that the difference in the time scale is exactly the difference that you have in the heterozygosity. Which this is, I believe, extremely important lesson for the rest of your life. And the extremely important lesson for the rest of your life is that if you take these two models are different, and are different in this picture of the world, in the sense that all the terms of the series are different, right? So if you recall the calculation we did 20 minutes ago about the Moran model, when we calculated alpha k of x, right, we found the terms that were much simpler than this, right? But just proportional to 1 over n to the power, and they were all proportional to x, 1 minus x. Here you have terms that are much more complicated. You have to go on Wikipedia, find the moments of the central moment of the binomial, recall that they are not equivalent, etc., etc., right? So all the if you keep all the terms, they are very different. The model details matter, right? The fourth term here is different from the Wright-Fisher model. Alpha 4 of x is different from the Wright-Fisher model and the Moran model. But when you take this continuous limit or the limit of large n, right? And so when you look at the system when n is large and the time scales are comparable to n, okay, all this difference, this detail don't matter. Okay. Don't matter because the only thing that matters is basically the variance of the jump. Okay. And this thing should remind you of something else, which is that there is a break now. No, should remind you of something else, right? So when, now I don't know if it should, because it's not a simple connection and I was probably not good enough to make this connection clear. But when you look at this, you are looking at the moments of the jumps. And somehow, when you are looking at the expansion here, you are only taking the second moment. And the deep reason of that, it's enough to take the second moment in these regimes, is that we are looking at time scales. We are looking at jumps in some sort of discrete space, okay? Whether this is diffusion or whether this is the Moran model or the Wright-Fisher model, we are looking at jumps in some discrete space, okay? And in all these cases, the lesson that we found, both in the diffusion, both in the Wright-Fisher model, both in the Moran model, is that we have to look at times which are order of the inverse of the jumps. And if you think of these jumps that are not identically distributed, but they are somehow uncorrelated, okay, what happens over when you look at large enough times, right, is that you are basically summing these jumps. Okay. And when you sum many independent variables over a large enough time, what do you get? You get the central limit theorem. Right? And the only thing that matters in the central limit theorem is the mean invariance, the first and the second moment. So the other way to say all this business here is that in some sense this is a manifestation of the central limit theorem. Is that you, if you're looking at time scale which are large enough, so if you look at the next time scale, what is the distribution of the jumps? Well, for the if you are in X, if you are in a given position, for the Moran model, the distribution of the jumps is a delta here and a delta here, right? You either go to X plus one over N or X minus one over N. While in the Wright-Fisher model, you are here and the distribution of the jumps is like a binomial, so something like this. Now, you're basically, over long time scale, you're keeping adding these numbers, okay? And when you keep adding these numbers, the only thing that matters is not the shape of the distribution, it's just the second one. Okay. So I think it's time to take a break, and we can reconvene this fantastic room in 7 minutes. Okay.
For after a long time, for the way reach the stationary state, what is the solution of this equation?
We are going to discuss that after the break.
Okay.
Any question from Zoom? Ah, there was a question half an hour ago. In the diffusion, what is V? For now, is a parameter. Okay. See you at noon, 10 past noon. Okay, questions. So let's start from last question. What can we say about this kind of equations? So in general, when you do all this business of expanding, looking at the next moment, what you find is that the first two terms, so in all the example that we've seen, the first term was always equal to zero. You never had the first term. But in general, for example, in the exercise, simple exercise I gave you, when you have the diffusion that is different from the left and the right, you see that there is also a first term. And these happens in general. And so the typical equation you find is an equation when you where you have the two terms. And this equation looks like something like minus dx of x t. You always forget about the two. Plus one of the two. So you find typical equation like this. In all the cases we have analyzed, the A of X was equal to zero, sometimes it's not. And this B of X was a constant in the random walk and was equal to X times one minus X in the Moran and Wright-Fisher walk. So this equation called Fokker-Planck equation. And as self-evident, it describes the evolution in time of a probability state. Now, you can, we will not describe in full glory the properties of this of the pocket plant distribution. One thing that I want to mention is that it should remind you of an equation you have seen many times in your life, which is no Schrödinger equation.
Yes.
Similar, you have an IH there in front of the derivative over time, but it's similar as an equation. So all the techniques you know to solve Schrödinger equations, you can apply to this case. Okay? So you can frame this as an eigenvalue problem and an operator, etc. So we will not go through it. In general, as you can imagine, in some cases is fully solvable, but the cases where it's fully solvable, where you can actually write the solution P of X T for some initial condition or some boundary conditions, are very limited and limits to cases. For the cases I just erased, it's actually possible to find the exact solution, and I'll send you a paper that does that. So for the case dt t equal to usually written this equation here, where I neglected the time constant in front because it's just an escape loop. So I'll send you a reference of the full solution of these in terms of time. The only thing I want to discuss is the interpretation of the terms A of X and B of X. Okay. I want to discuss that, and I want to discuss the existence and the form of the stationary distribution. Okay. So the first thing I want to say is, what is the interpretation of the terms A of X and B of X? And you can easily imagine that from this equation, I can derive the evolution in time of the average value of X. Okay. How do you do that? Well, this is just equal by definition, the integral of X. Okay. And so if you substitute this on the right hand side, and then you do many integration by parts, you arrive to a final expression, okay, which is pretty, these are pretty straightforward passages, just involving integration by parts. And what you end up with is that this is equal to the average, well, the integral in dx. Okay. You can sort of see that this corresponds to the first term. So if you substitute this here, you have an integral in dx x d dx a of x d of x. If you integrate by part, you get a minus, which cancels this minus. This goes here, cancels this x, and you get that part, the term. And then all the other terms, these terms becomes equal to zero, and the other terms. You can do that, it's not. And this is equal to AX P over top. Yeah, so this is equal to average. You see that you have an equation which is like PX P average P over. So the important point I want to make is that this A of X, two important points as always. One important point is that this A of X contains all the information about what is the force that drives the change in the average value of the variable. Okay. This is something related to the direction that the system takes, where the average goes. On the other hand, this term is very unfortunately different from A of the average X. So this term here, what is the change in X, does not depend only on the average of X, depend on the full moment of X, depends on the full function, on the expectation value. So it depends also on the variability that you have in the variable, okay? If you repeat the same calculation for the second, for the variance, so for, what you find is that this is equal to X minus X of X plus the average of X. So the variance of the distribution changes because of two terms. Now I'm sort of giving an interpretation to these equations here in terms of the terms E of X. Changes because there is the term A of X and the values of X are not equal to the average. Okay. So if you interpret this A as a force that change the values of X, okay, the fact that you have a distribution, that you have values of X that are different from the average, implies that there are different values of X that feel a different force. Okay. And therefore, this contributes to the variance. And then the term V of X is a source of this variability. So imagine that you are in a condition where all the X are equal to the average. If all the X are equal to the average, this term is zero. But this term, so if all the terms are equal to the average, the variance is zero. This term is zero, but this term is not zero in general. And so it's what creates variability.
Okay. What are the conditions for the upper plane equation?
Oh. In what sense? So well, you can write.
We have the entire series and we stay away from all the
it's not something where you write a condition. I mean, this is an important point that I think sometimes is misunderstood. So it's not that you write a model. This model depends on some parameters. Okay. In this model, which you can write, for which you can write, let's say, a master equation, if you want to fully solve the models for all the values of parameters, depends on all the Kramers-Mouillard expansion, so all the terms. Now, in some cases, actually, most of the cases, you're not interested in any possible values of the parameters. You have some parameters which are very large, some that are very small. Okay. Those cases when you have parameters, for instance, typically you are interested in populations that are large numbers, right? Where capital N is a large number, much larger than one. If that is the case, all the contributions that are here are subleading. Right. So are corrections that are order one over some power of N. So these corrections you can neglect because you have a large population. But you have a population of 100 individuals, that is not a good description. Okay?
So the procedure would be like always take the full expansion and then neglect the depending on what
well, yes, this is the procedure in the same way as every time you have to use some mathematical result, you prove a theorem. Right? So, you know what are the conditions, you know that that all this term goes to zero, and so you know that you take the first terms. Yes.
But like if the monier doesn't follow the equilibrium theorem, you cannot.
Yes, if the for instance, that's true. So there are limits. So if you if the models, if the distribution of the moments, if the moments are not finite, yes, you have problems. Okay. Other questions about this? So you have the interpretation of these two results. And actually, how many of you, if I say Langevin equation, know what I'm talking about? Please, okay. How many of you, because then nobody's gonna raise the hand because he's afraid that I'm gonna. So how many of you, if I say Langevin equation, they say what? Two. Okay. So I'll say something that you can forget. Okay. So in the sense that I will not introduce Langevin equation here, but I want to make a connection for people that that don't know what a Langevin equation is. Okay? That know what a Langevin equation is. So the Fokker-Planck equation is equivalent to a Langevin equation. But if I say linear process, it's not important. It's just a linear equation. I mean, it's important, but it's not important. So you can actually write, well, I'll do an introduction, so you can actually write an equation. This is an equation for the probability, right? How the probability changes in time. Now you could ask, but can I generate trajectories of X that obeys to that equation? Right. So this is describes how the probability changes, right? And I can simulate the discrete process like the Moran model and generate these discrete trajectories. Can I generate trajectories that obey to this process? So you can use stochastic differential equations. And you can write an equation that looks like x dot equals something. This x dot equals something to have that process there is something where x dot is equal to a of x plus the square root of 2b of x. Where this term here is a white noise. You knew what a Langevin was. So this C of T, CT prime, is a delta correlated noise. Okay? And the average delta correlated Gaussian noise. That equation there corresponds to this, and you go back and forth. Okay, good. And you can see, for instance, that if you take the average now, here becomes apparent that if you take the average here, you get the average of this and this. Again, this is another hole or rabbit hole where I could dive in and stay there for. Weeks, but we have only three more lectures. Okay, questions? Okay, so this is what I wanted to tell you about Fokker-Planck equation. There is only one thing left that I'm gonna tell you, and then I stop. So this is the interpretation of the terms. So A acts as something that it's like a term that moves you, that produce a force to the system. And this term is the amplitude of the noise of the fluctuations, right? So these are white noise fluctuations. So you can imagine that these are at every time step there is a small random variable that you add. Do you know how to simulate this? Well, to simulate this, you have to just you can generate trajectories like this.
Huh? No, we are doing this.
Okay. Plus delta p a of x. Plus 2 d of x delta t. So you basically you discretize, if you discretize this, you have what you expect with the difference that the delta t here is inside the square. Okay. So what you do is that you have discrete time step, you go to t delta t. At every time step, you generate the x t plus delta t as this, plus this term where this is a random variable. from a Gaussian distribution with mean zero and variance one. This is the simplest way to generate. Of course, this is like the Euler method for, well, blah, 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 blah. Okay? Yes.
Why did you say this?
It's the blah, 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 blah that I don't take. So the reason is that you can imagine, I mean, you can imagine that as you add these terms, right? Imagine that you add all these terms to each other. So you this generates a distribution. Okay. So this is a sum of independent terms. Okay. And this sum of independent terms. Well, no, the best way is to say it like this. So if you look at the distribution around these, how do I want to say that? Well, okay, let me say in brief. You can prove that if this is not the square root of delta t, okay, scales at delta t, as you take the limit. So the key point is that this limit is a little bit tricky because here you are summing independent variables. And if you decrease this delta t by two, you sum two independent variables, right, to each other. So you want that the variance, how do I explain this in 5 seconds without? Okay. Okay, let me give you the short answer and then I'll give you the full answer after the class. Okay, the short answer is if you take this proportional to delta t, okay, you find that in the large time limit, so as you increase this t, these terms become subleading to the compared to this. So the fluctuations are small, okay, and don't count. This is the short answer. I can give you an intuition of why that is true after that. Okay. Stationary distribution. How do you find the stationary distribution? You set this equal to zero. If you set this equal to zero, what you get is minus d x over x d over x t plus 1/2 which of course you can write as the derivative minus a of x d over x t. Well, I want to set this equal to zero. Okay. I want to set this equal to zero. Now, this in principle implies that this term here is equal to a constant. Now, this is in some sense analogous to when we were trying to find the stationary distribution of the master equation. And this constant, you can show that this constant has to be actually equal to zero, because if you want that this distribution is well behaved for large values of x. Okay. So you don't want that this term, when you go to the extreme of your domain, is finite. So if this tends to zero, the constant has to be equal to zero. Now there will be a very interesting parenthesis to open if this was a multidimensional equation, more than one dimension, which I will not open. Okay. there are too many parentheses that we cannot. This is what we have. Okay? So this is the stationary distribution. And this equation you can solve. Right? You can solve this equation because you get, let me call this U of X. So what you have is
multiply for it.
Huh?
Multiply for U of X.
Yes. So this is what the question you have is the derivative U of X is equal to U of X.
A of X divided by B of X.
Yes, exactly. Yes, that's why. U of X divided by B of X. Okay. So you can solve this, and this is Q of X is equal to dimension to the integral. From whatever limit you want, I'm gonna go to this limit in a second. Dz of v z, and therefore you find that p star of x is equal to 1/v(x) exponential of 2. You are free to choose this limit of integration as you want, because here you actually have a normalization factor, which is determined by the initial condition. Okay. So this gives the solution of the Fokker-Planck equation. Okay. Now let's open this. Questions on this? So in one dimension you can always solve it. Let me open two parentheses. Parenthesis one. X dot is equal to minus dv x plus square root of 2k dt. See? No, u of x. Didn't say anything, so parenthesis two, the parenthesis that I didn't open, but I feel the urge to tell you. What if this is in higher dimension? Okay. Before going to higher dimension, is this clear? So you, if you have that for Fokker-Planck, you can always write the stationary solution. What if this was in higher dimension? If this is in higher dimension, what you have here is that you have, well, here you have eyes, you have an eye here, some other eye, and here you have some bij, xi, dj, a sum over I and j. Okay? If you were in higher dimension, so you have also these indexes, right? And these x, of course, are vectors. So when you write this equation, here you have You can write this as the derivative over I minus here, sum over I. And here you have the derivative j over j. So you have some term here, which I can call j of x. So of course a vector now, j of x t, but j of x star. Okay. And I have an equation which is like sum over I d dxi j. I R of X equal to zero. Okay. So what is this? A divergence, right? So you have a divergence equal to zero. Okay. Now, the fact that you have a divergence equal to zero, okay, you want to say this, this one. So you have the divergence equal to zero, okay. The fact that the divergence is equal to zero, and the fact that the you have two things, divergence equal to zero and ji of x tends to zero on the boundary. For instance, for x tending to zero. In one dimension, these two conditions together, so this condition in one dimension implies that ji of x is constant in one dimension. Because this is just one derivative, it implies that j of x is constant, and this condition implies that that constant is equal to zero. And this is what you use to solve the stationary solution. In higher dimension, the fact that this is a zero and this is zero don't imply that the function has to be a constant and has to be equal to zero. Okay. Because you can have rotational, you can have a curve different. The fundamental difference between one and higher dimension is that you cannot use this condition to claim that all these terms are equal to zero. And therefore, in general, it's much harder to find the stationary solution. And the fact that you cannot do this is related to non-equilibrium, lack of detailed balance, etc. This was another parenthesis that now I close. Okay. To make a conclusion. Questions, doubts, comments. So all the parentheses, I mean, the problem is that one will need 10 years to explain everything and it should not be enough. So I know that opening these parentheses and be not precise is frustrating from one end, but if you want, I mean, if you're interested in something that I say in that respect, write me and I tell you more, or I send you references, etc. Okay, it's just to make connections with other things you might find. Questions? Yes.
Within this way, the compact time equation,
yes. It looks like a continuity equation, and the fact that it is a continuity equation is because probability, the total probability, the integral of the probability is conserved because it's normalized to one. Is a probability. Yes. See you.